The presider of this panel, Professor Meena Alexander, I had the privilege of introducing the previous presider, one of our distinguished professors at CUNY. Meena is our second distinguished professor here of English and Women's Studies at Hunter College and the Graduate Center of City University. Her poems and prose works have been widely anthologized and translated into several languages, including Arabic, Malayalam, Hindi, Japanese, Italian, French, German, and Swedish. Her works include the memoir Fault Lines, selected by Publishers Weekly as one of the best books of that year, a volume of poems and prose pieces on the immigrant life. And like I said earlier, I can go on and on, but a distinguished professor is a distinguished professor, does not need any more introduction. Meena?
Well, thank you very much. After that most gracious introduction, I hardly know what to say. But I would like to start by saying I'm so very pleased to be here at Baruch College. This is my very first time in Baruch. I've been at CUNY for many years, but this is the first time I've had a chance to enter Baruch College. And particularly, I think, to be chairing such a very interesting panel. We have quite a treat in store for us today, because we have a series of presentations that range quite widely around issues of women, survival, and creativity. And I say it in that order because I think issues of creativity also involve survival, psychic survival. And I think that many of the presentations in their different ways will involve issues of diaspora and of making a home, whether it be through literature or the analysis of literature, whether it be through activism or through the creation of fine art. So I will just briefly introduce each of the presenters in the order in which they will, do their presentations. And just wanted to say that if there's anything I've left out, please feel free to introduce yourselves as well. So we will start with Siona Benjamin, who is a painter originally from Bombay and now living in the United States. And her work reflects her background of being brought up Jewish in a predominantly Hindu and Muslim India. And so already you have the multiculturalism of India entering her work. In her paintings, she combines the imagery of past with a role she plays in America, making a mosaic, and I'm quoting, inspired by both Indian miniature paintings and Sephardic icons. And she has an MFA in painting and another MFA in theater, and she has exhibited widely at numerous venues and exhibitions. She is the recipient of a 2004 fellowship from the New Jersey State Council on the Arts. We will then have Jaskiran Mathur, who is with SAKHI for South Asian Women, which is an extremely important women's advocacy group in New York, and indeed a very important group in the United States. And I will just read, if that's all right, I'll just read your bio from here, because that is what I've been given. She is a sociologist from India, with a background in gender issues, rehabilitation, development, and voluntary work with rural and urban women in India and the United States. And she's been in the United States since 1998 and has worked variously with the World Bank, UNESCO, and has taught also at Teachers College and is currently teaching at St. Francis College. And our last but not least in our order of presentation is Sunita Peacock, who is going to be talking about literature, South Asian literature, and she is an assistant professor of English at Slippery Rock University in Pennsylvania. And she, I'm just looking for her bio. She teaches classes such as Eastern and World Literature, which of course will be of interest to this group, and graduated with her PhD from Southern Illinois University. And her major there was Modern British Literature, and then she also minored in Women in Postcolonial Theory. And let me just run through just the titles of the presentations, because I think those are really of interest to us. Siona Benjamin's topic is called Finding Home and the Dilemma of Belonging. Jaskiran Mathur's topic is Empowerment, the SAKHI Experience. I expect she'll be talking directly about her work with SAKHI. And Sunita Peacock's topic is The Negotiation of Space, Interrogating Identity in the Lives of South Asian Indians. And I would like to request the speakers to speak for about 15 minutes, perhaps a little bit more, so that we, not more than 20, so that we have a chance for discussion at the end. Thank you very much. So please welcome our first presenter.
My gadgets. Thanks for inviting me. I'm going to show slides. I'm a painter, so just give us a minute. And I hope you can see the visuals. I didn't anticipate the skylight, so it's going to be a little, is it fine? Yes, okay. Okay. In the mythology of India, a yogini is a female ascetic, as in the slide from the book Devi, the Great Goddess by Vidya Dehaja, a sorceress or witch, an attendant of Durga or Devi. Yoginis, like their male counterparts, renounce society's norms to seek spiritual knowledge, magical powers, or immortality through the practice of yoga. Through yoga, the yogini strives to achieve samadhi, a state in which the practitioner of yoga transcends duality by recognizing the self and universe as one. These supernatural powers range from extraordinary wisdom, the ability to fly, to enter the bodies of beautiful women and animals, to revive the dead, and to foretell the future. In the devotee's desperate longing for enlightenment, the yogini also has to suffer extreme austerities in an effort to attain spiritual bliss. The yoginis in my paintings are in search of similar powers. In today's world, much needs to be done to counteract the effects of war and intolerance, the seeds of destitution. As I sat in my studio one morning contemplating my previous night's work, I felt both a great strength in the power of being an artist, but at the same time I felt a great sense of helplessness. What could my art possibly contribute that might help? The yoginis in my paintings were painted shortly after, possessing both the powers and the aspirations of the age-old ascetics. In Finding Home number 41, a self-portrait in which I'm holding a fly swatter, standing atop a hill and wearing my bathrobe, which suggests domesticity, I am able to do absolutely nothing about the two hands that appear below that aim guns at each other. It is during mundane activities of life that profound realizations may suddenly dawn. In the second of the yogini paintings, number 42, I brush my teeth and the water flows uncontrollably from a tap at my feet. I hold a mirror up to the viewer, asking if he, she is the culprit, the cause, the wrongdoer, the instigator, the demon. In Finding Home number 43, like the yoginis of before, I lay on a bed of nails in penance while my bathrobe drips blood. My daughter, in the garb of an angel from Persian miniature, brings in the Hebrew letter Aleph on a golden platter, perhaps suggesting the return of the beginning and hope. The bathrobe repeats in every time, weaving the Shema, a Hebrew prayer taught to me in my childhood, into its fabric, sometimes dripping blood, sometimes becoming a fearsome flame. In Finding Home number 44, I incarnate myself into a Kali-like woman. With my robe flaming behind me, I overcome a nuclear weapon by crushing it underfoot, its black oily blood oozing. Hope never really left as I hold it securely as a small yellow flame against my breast. It's kind of faded, isn't it? Okay, anyway. In this series of paintings entitled Finding Home, I raise questions about what and where is home while evoking issues such as identity, immigration, motherhood, and the role of art in social change. I am a Ben Israel Jew from India. My family gradually dispersed, mostly to America and to Israel, but my parents remained in India. I am also now an American living and working in New Jersey, and to add to the fact that I'm married to a Polish-Russian man from Connecticut. With such a background, the desire to find home, spiritually and literally, has always preoccupied me. The feeling I have of never being able to set deep roots, no matter where I am, is unnerving. But on the other hand, there is something seductive about the spiritual borderland in which I seem to find myself. The next few slides I'm going to show you are just like a couple slides of Jewish India, just for you to get an idea. This is a map I found in the New York Public Library that talked about how different waves of Jews came to India along with all the other groups, Parsis and the Greeks and Portuguese and everybody else. So. We don't have enough time, but I'll just show you. This is a synagogue, one of the synagogues I grew up in Bombay, in the city of Bombay, Magin Hasidim Synagogue. And this is the famous Cochin Synagogue, which was built in the 15th century in South India. And this is one of the many synagogues in India, just to give you an idea. And this is actually Sefer Torahs. They're prayer scrolls, which are contained in containers, decorative containers. And actually, the one to your right is from India, and the one to your left is from Iran. Recently, I've been studying the Torah, the five books of Moses, and the Talmud, rabbinical interpretations with a rabbi in my town. While growing up in India, I recall being surrounded by idols and iconography that were taboo in my Jewish world. I eyed these figures from a distance, captivated with their radiance and richness. Since Judaism stressed monotheism and iconoclasm, I somehow resisted the lure of figurative drawing for years, initially making abstract work, and then later, if I did venture to depict the forbidden fruit, my figures were shrouded with darkened faces. This is some of my earlier work, really earlier work. Now my work is filled with graven images, as suddenly it has become clear during my years studying and designing sets for theater that I like the narrative, the theatrical, the decorative line. This ornateness I carried with me all along. These figures have thus become characters in my paintings that act out their parts, restoring, balancing, rectifying, recording, and absorbing. Some of my idols are painters like Leonora Carrington and Remedios Varo, who are surrealist women artists. These are some examples of my work, and there's no time to explain each one of them, but if you remember any particular painting and want to ask a question about it, please do later on. It is through all this that I understand how I can dip into my own personal specifics and universalize, thus playing the role of an artist activist. This one's called Venus, to tell you in short. I did this after I was appalled by the last elections. So Venus being a symbol of Western culture, so to speak, having studied Western art. But in this case, she's counting chads. She's holding up a ballot card, holding up her own tattered halo, a crystal ball to look into the future, and she's picking up her own dress to reveal a bloodied army boot. So, you know, kind of taking symbols from both Western and Eastern mythology and art, and kind of working with that. In the mixed media series titled Spicy Girl, I address modern American culture in context to my own background, having lived in these two diverse cultural settings. Spicy Girl projects an in-your-face attitude not only towards American culture, but also towards the stereotypes of Asian women. The first example is called All-Rounders Techniques of Ecstasy. And these are like mixed media found object assemblages, kind of like in the spirit of making toys that I venture into doing in between the more serious work, which is the Indian miniature painting influenced work. So they open up, that's the closed and the open view. Can you guys really see? I mean, is it really faded? Okay. And then the second one is called Spicy Girl, Don't Get Her Started. It's actually, found object boxes, but I've used like a little starter button for her dot, because how many times have I been asked, are Indian women born with that dots on the forehead or something like that? So I kind of decided, instead of shaking my angry fist at them and saying, oh, how come you don't know? I kind of decided to kind of handle it with humor. This one's called Don't Get Her Started. That's the outside view, and this is the inside when you open the box. So these are the fun boxes that I like to make in a way. But going back to the Finding Home series, in the painting Finding Home number 28, inspired by this Indian miniature painting, and where a court scene of a woman sitting smoking a hookah, with her her courtesans around her or whatever. Inspired by that, is it clear? Not sure. Okay. In Finding Home number 28, a figure, myself, in blue jeans, is seated in a traditional miniature landscape, is sipping Coke through a long straw, which suggests a hookah. I'm imbibing the intoxicating American elixir poison Coca-Cola, symbolizing the lure of the West, which draws me to reside in the U.S. In the background, the house says mother, or ima in Hebrew, and represents the home I was leaving when I immigrated to the U.S. The once lush foliage and blooming lotuses in the pond are now wilted, and the water is filled with trash and pollution. There is a demon on top of the painting with a gun and nuclear weapon, suggesting that war will infiltrate and further disrupt the scene. However, a protective angel is also in the background with my mother's Sabbath lamp, and the entire scene is set within the protective border of the central Hebrew prayer, ensuring that my Jewish spiritual identity might also travel to me into my new home. And inspired by Bollywood movies, which I grew up in. Actually, I grew up in Bombay, in Bandra, and my mother ran a Montessori school for 20 years, and so all these film star kids would come to my mother's school. So it was quite a scene around my house every morning when they came to drop the kids off. So inspired by that, this one's called Finding on Number 49, Zarina's Encounter with Mr. Eastwood. What's this one? Questions who is in whose space. Is he in hers or vice versa? The resident alien card, which I recently gave up to acquire my American citizenship, is disguised under a Persian carpet. Around the painting, it says in Hindi, I was dancing. Suddenly my feet stopped. Who is that stranger? Why is that helicopter after him? Oh Allah, what should I do? And in Finding Home number 31, around the painting in the border, I have written, it was a quiet day in the desert. I almost fell off my camel and knew that I must have reached America when I saw a starfighter spaceship fly by. In Finding Home number 45, titled Sister, is done in response to the Middle East crisis. Since most of my family immigrated to Israel from India, thus I formed this two-headed, several-armed woman, half Jewish and half Muslim. Both her hands display the rich henna of her similarities, of their similarities. They seem peaceful, yet in front of them there is a blasting plunger and wires that indicate a bomb connected to them. Will they destroy themselves, or is there any hope that they will be saved from themselves? In Finding Home number 56, titled Zakham, which means wound in Urdu, is inspired from a page in the Quran, but also from Jewish illuminated manuscripts. Are the swords a weapon that will defend her, or are they a protection against unforeseen dangers? What seems like Urdu or Arabic writing above actually spells out it's unfortunate in English. Oh, you can't see it. Anyway. And this is the bottom detail of the painting, if you can see. In Finding Home number 61, titled Beloved, unable to deal with the conflict between Sarah and Hagar, Abraham tells Sarah to do what is right in her eyes. Although Abraham has been instructed by God to listen to Sarah's wishes, this being the version taught to me in my Jewish Torah, he seems not to care when Ishmael, his son, is banished into the wilderness with his mother Hagar. This competition between the two mothers results in a rift between them, since Sarah tries to safeguard the rights of her son, Isaac. The Sarah and Hagar in my painting, titled Beloved, are reunited. In deep embrace, they are mere reflections of each other. Being raised Jewish in a Hindu-Muslim India, I grew up having close friendships with Muslims. I cannot but see the similarities we share as human beings, not our differences. But danger lurks, as out of the shadows comes a youth offering a friendly extended hand. I don't know if you can see that detail, but it's to this side. Strapped to his chest are bombs that will explode only if he can draw the attention of Sarah and Hagar. The amputee soldier cannot save them, can he? The camera has spotted the suicide bomber, but will he be stopped in time and the fragments of Sarah and Hagar's bodies be put back together again? And this is the detail. I don't know if you can see some of the outlines on the side. Yeah, you couldn't see that in the other slide. Okay. In finding one number 64, titled Hagar, Hagar, with her son Ishmael, leaves home and embarks on her personal Lech Lecha, which means in Hebrew means going forth into the desert. Dying of thirst, she encounters water and quenches her and her son's thirst. Water is often a symbol of spiritual belief and strength in the Torah. She encounters water, and thus her spirituality is rekindled. The Hagar in my painting encounters water and is surrounded by it. She walks and floats on it. Her Moses-style staff has reduced the nuclear mushroom cloud and has contained it under water. But all the water is undrinkable, as within it are the fragmented bodies from a suicide bombing. Is she Hindu or Muslim from the India I left behind, or both? The threads of her fabric unravel, or do they grow to become trees, while her many, many homes fly away on the fabric of her sari sky? The last few pieces. Finding on number 63, titled Ruth. Ruth the Moabite, as she was originally from Moab, a nation bordering Israel, refuses to leave her widowed mother-in-law Naomi. Being a young widow herself, she says to Naomi, your people are my people and your God my God. Like Abraham, she has also performed Lech Lecha, which is growing forth by coming into the new land of Israel and leaving her own homeland. The character Ruth strikes me as faithful, benevolent, and altruistic. By learning about these various characters in the Torah, I found the study to be rather like analyzing characters from a Shakespeare play. After learning as much as I could about the roles they played, I wished to make my interpretation or midrash. Instead of painting them in their time and setting, I wish to bring them forward to our times and have them combat today's evils, wars, nuclear weapons, and intolerance. How would Ruth react? How would she contain, destroy, or stop the injustices of today? I imagine that given her benevolence, she would ingest the weapon. She would swallow the dagger that threatens to destroy, and with this effort, she would hope to arrest the mushroom cloud even before it envelops the world into darkness. And there's a detail of this, so you can see something of it. Finding on number 60, My Magic Carpet. It's titled My Magic Carpet. Someday Palestine were the words I grew up hearing my grandmother say, and she did immigrate to Israel eventually. Did the magic carpet transport to the promised land, or did it dislocate? Her one hand transforms into a paintbrush. Is it paint or blood that flows wasted into the drain? Two of her many hands are shackled, but does she know that she holds the key? She balances a bowl that collects golden drops, or is it acid rain? While one claw-like hand destroys her own painting, the two hands above rekindle a flame of hope. I think I have a detail. And by the way, these are all gouache on paper, or gouache and 22-karat gold leaf on paper, or gouache and 22-karat gold leaf on wood panel. And one of the last pieces, finding on number 46, is titled Tikkun HaOlam, which means the reconstruction of the world, is inspired from a concept in Kabbalah, which is a sort of Jewish mysticism. Here the world is compared to a pot or a vessel and contains all the virtues, which contains all the virtues. However, the cosmos was unable to contain this divine energy and the pot shattered, but the broken shards retain the divine energy or light. It is humanity's task to reconstruct this vessel, which is done through various ethical, spiritual, intellectual, and aesthetic acts which re-establish values in our world. By making images that contribute to this tikkun, or reconstruction, I am thus participating in my own small way in this process of restoration or reconstruction. Thank you.
As I have been introduced, I am a sociologist, and at present I teach at St. Francis College in Brooklyn. My association with SAKHI has been as long as my stay in the United States of America. I was a volunteer with SAKHI, and then I worked for SAKHI very, very briefly as their domestic violence program coordinator, and have been on the SAKHI board for the last 3 years. So today I am here actually to talk about SAKHI and the SAKHI experience. And I would, just to give you a little bit of background on SAKHI, I'm going to request, is Lavina here? Liv, okay, she'll probably be coming in. Okay, Lavina Ahmed is an intern at SAKHI, and she's just going to hand out some SAKHI statistics to you. She is the outreach and communications intern at SAKHI these days. SAKHI has grown a lot in the last 15 years that it has made its presence felt in New York City. And it is an organization which has been dedicated to working for South Asian women. And I'm sure in this particular forum, I don't have to explain what is South Asian, which is something which we usually have to do when we start talking about SAKHI in our outreach work. As it was established in 1989, this year, we proudly celebrate 15 years of survival, strength, and sisterhood, as we say. SAKHI has grown to be an organization which now handles much more than it had ever expected to. And we have, of course, always said it's an organization with a death wish, because we live for the day when we will not need to exist. And we started off because of our concern about women who are victims of domestic violence. And it is inevitable that when you take up one particular issue, which is problematic in society, your attention is instantly drawn to other issues which are closely connected with that issue. So our main program was domestic violence and how to respond to it. That was the humble aim, because responding to it was all we were talking about at that point. And of course, we didn't want to limit ourselves to a band-aid kind of approach, but all we could do was be there for women who were so far away from home, very much like Ruth, following in the footsteps of spouses, families, and their people being the people of these women, and their gods being the gods of these women, and then finding themselves adrift sometimes in a problematic situation. So SAKHI, as the name connotes, in most South Asian languages, it means female friend. SAKHI tried to be a friend, a year, provide a year for these women. This humble beginning of being an organization where women could find people who were, familiar with the culture and maybe with languages, and come for direction, obviously grew to include an effort towards community outreach, and also to raise awareness, because there was no point in having an organization which people did not know about. There was no point in having an organization which did not bring to people's notice that this is a problem within this community, and we have to acknowledge it. And let me assure you that that has not been a very sort of quick process. This acknowledgement has come really slow, but it has come gradually. And of course, to be able to, be a source for people who required help, to provide them that help and information and guidance. To raise awareness amongst the women who approach SAKHI for help, and to raise awareness within the South Asian community that domestic violence is a problem which we don't like, but it does exist within our community, has been an important task. So that's how the second task of SAKHI came. That was community outreach and awareness raising. Closely connected to that was our economic empowerment program, which is a fledgling program, but it was important, because any kind of efforts to help women would be meaningless unless they could be directed to some viable options. They could be directed in a direction where they could stand on their own feet or could, you know, find their own way. Empowerment is what I'm going to focus on, but, you know, after I tell you a little bit about the SAKHI background. So economic empowerment, which began with some English classes and computer training, is an ongoing process and something which we are working hard towards increasing and expanding as a program. And from our realization that violence and abuse is not just a physical or even an emotional thing, it has immense repercussions in terms of health and other, you know, both mental health and physical health, as well as the health of the community. The health initiative which SAKHI has taken up is another major program which we are working on, and we have thus, from these initiatives which are very, very sort of grassroots and ground level, moved also to the idea that we could and should be delving into and trying to influence policy, because you can't just keep putting band-aids on problems without trying to stem these problems. And I would just like to introduce you to one of our major efforts where we are trying to work on policy, and that is a court interpreters program, where we have been trying to bring to the notice of New York State and New York City court systems that court interpretation in South Asian languages is either not available or highly inadequate, and justice misinterpreted or refracted is definitely justice denied. So that is something which we need to focus on as well. That is one of the things which we've been most recently working. So that's just a brief update on the kind of things SAKHI has been doing in the last 15 years and where we are today. In 2003, we received a total number of 515 calls for appeal. You have the statistics with you, so I don't need to go into details. And these calls were coming from women spread across the South Asian community, though we don't specifically have any survivor whom we're working with from last year, from Sri Lanka, but we do have people we've been we have ongoing work with before that. But India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, the Indo-Caribbean community, Nepal, Burma, Afghanistan, and some non-South Asian countries too have been reflected in our statistics and in the calls for appeal that we've had. We have also been working in all the boroughs of New York City, and we also have been responding to appeals from the tri-state area and a lot of appeals from outside other states, as well as even from India and the countries and the homeland for some of the other survivors who have been approaching us. So given this kind of an environment, we definitely don't seem to be getting very close to our goal, that is eradicating violence completely or to doing away with SAKHI as an organization, because the community doesn't need it anymore. But we're trying to make it an organization which makes its presence felt and does perform. The handout which has been distributed has testimonials from people who have been helped by SAKHI. We have the time, I may read out a couple for you. Meanwhile, I would just like to go to the topic which I had chosen for today's presentation, and that is empowerment. Sociologically speaking, and talking about development, which I have always been interested in, I'm going to borrow André Bithé's definition of empowerment and say that empowerment is about social transformation. And it is about the people. And I'm talking about ordinary people, common people, not people who are politicians or experts or some other socially or culturally advantaged persons. Empowerment, therefore, is a process of building capacities and confidence for taking decisions about one's own life at an individual and collective level and gaining control over productive resources. The empowerment process is facilitated by creating awareness about one's rights and responsibilities and socioeconomic, educational, and political opportunities, by developing skills for utilizing productive resources, and by involving oneself in collective activities and community life. Empowerment is about change in favor of those who previously exercised very little control over their lives. And this is an effort which is ongoing in most communities, because there is a realization, at least theoretically, by most governments, by most agencies, that there is no way that development can be a real thing, or there is no way that we can have real social change unless those who are disempowered can be empowered. In the earlier session, we heard a presentation about the microcredit experience in Bangladesh, which has become a byword as a success story from the Grameen Bank experience. And microcredit groups or other self-help groups have been tapped for in the process of empowerment or to partner in empowerment exercises. The SAKHI experience is an experience which is closely linked to this. We have not been able to create a cooperative or a self-help group, but we are an NGO, we are a voluntary organization, what is called an NGO back home, and we do try and facilitate the process of people becoming aware of their rights and of ways to empower themselves and of ways to solve the problems that they have faced, because these people, for various reasons, social, political, personal, have been denied, even cultural, have been denied access to this kind of information and this kind of knowledge. The basic understanding over here is that there can be no true empowerment or true social change unless the community within which those who are exploited or those who are resourceless, the community in which these people exist, recognizes the role that it plays in creating this environment. Why I'm bringing up this issue is because very often in the SAKHI efforts, we have come across a response which is very disturbing, and that is that this is a cultural thing. The position of women in our society is the way it is because we culturally expect our women to behave in a particular way, or we have certain, our families have a particular makeup because of our culture. That is using culture as a scapegoat, because culture is constructed and man-made. It's not something which is a revelation from above. And we have created this culture, which is exploitative, and obviously there's vested interests, so obviously it has become hidebound in tradition. But to say that this is cultural, therefore we cannot interfere with it, or there isn't much to do with it, and that, or you know, to pretend that this is something which is restricted to certain groups and certain communities. We had this interesting explanation about the leather workers also in the earlier session, which I found so amusing, because it does make a lot of sense to say that we don't kill the cows or the pigs. I mean, they're dead already for another purpose. We just work, you know, on the leather, which is sort of a byproduct of the killing, which was for meat or whatever else. And if you talk about the South Asian experience, especially the Indian culture, we had a caste system which actually made institutionalized and displayed the function. And we had people who were tanners and worked with leather traditionally who were outcasts. Nobody else even affiliated with them. It's another matter that they used the products, but they didn't have anything to do with these unclean people who did unclean jobs. But there was, you know, a slot for them in society. So of course society has a way of rationalizing and explaining what is happening, what exists within it, and obviously serves some vested interests, serves some purposes. What we have been experiencing is that there is no point in just dealing with people who have been the victims of some of the exploitation which society meets out, or have been victims of circumstances, unless we can influence society or bring to the notice of society that these problems have to be dealt with by the society itself. It's not just enough to say policy. We know from the experience, again from South Asia, within those countries, that there are laws, some very progressive laws which exist. We have laws if you look at progressive laws, where maternity leave is concerned, I think South Asian laws are really so progressive that I was horrified to find that there was hardly any maternity leave when I talked to my colleagues in the United States of America, and I had availed of 3 months of maternity leave when my son was born in India, and I thought that was such a good thing, such a progressive thing, and I didn't realize, I just took it for granted when I was there. But you see, you can introduce laws, but it's different for a professor to avail of those laws, or it's different for a person who is aware, you know, about what their rights are to avail of whatever facilities you have. The laws otherwise remain in the books, and awareness then becomes an issue. And if people are not made aware of what they are entitled to, it makes no sense having the laws in the books, etc. So there has to be a connection made between what people are experiencing, what they should know in terms of alleviating their suffering, how what the community's role in that suffering and alleviating that suffering is, and the community should sit up and take, you know, responsibility for it. So it is only organizations which work with the victims and work with the community and have a knowledge about the cultures to which these communities and the victims belong, it's only such organizations which can help to bridge these gaps or can, you know, can say we belong to the same community, we're coming from the same place, and we think some introspection is required, or we think these connections need to be made. And this is an effort which, you know, we are in the process of. And the SAKHI experience, let me, you know, sort of summarize it for you. I'm going to just read out one or two of the endorsements we have from people we've helped. I'm going to read out the experience of Rashida from Lahore, Pakistan. She's 25 years old. The names are disguised, by the way. The words are their own. She says, my fault was that I had a master's degree. When I got married, I was very happy that my husband was settled in America and I was joining him in the land of dreams. But soon I realized that he was a very short-tempered man who wanted me to constantly fulfill his wishes, and that was family. I was routinely taunted and told, you think you're too educated, but that means nothing because I control you and will do only what I want. I was his prisoner and I thought I would die. Then my neighbor told me about SAKHI and accompanied me to the office. They helped me in many ways, including helping me get back on my feet. With SAKHI's help, I applied for scholarships, and now I'm studying computer science at my local college. Today, I can envision a better future. It's probably a simplistic explanation of a very complicated life, but it is a spontaneous response to the fact that she did find some help and you know, some support in a place which was so far away from her home. I'm willing to respond to whatever questions you have about SAKHI's work when we're done with our presentations, because I don't want to exceed the time which has been allocated to me. So thank you for listening and thank you for supporting.
Okay, in this paper, I would like to interrogate the identity and space of South Asian immigrants in the United States. I plan to do this through the fiction works of Bharti Mukherjee and Jhumpa Lahiri, and theorists such as Homi Bhabha and Gayatri Spivak Chakravarti, and other Indian critics who question the identities of Indian immigrants in their writings. I will also examine just one article. I had several, but I'm just going to look at one from news magazines, so popular culture too, to show how Indian immigrants are trying to negotiate a space and identity for themselves in mainstream American society. Before looking at the lives of Indian immigrants in the US, one has to examine the history of immigration of this particular group into the continent. The influx of Indian immigrants began as early as the 1890s, mostly as agricultural workers and as loggers in the United States and Canada. The next group arrived in the late 60s. This was the time period of the Vietnam War, when a heated economy created demand for professionals willing to work for low pay, especially in the field of medicine. Later in the 1980s, immigration began instituting stricter laws, and this brought about a different kind of Indian immigrant, one who belonged to a slightly poorer class and took jobs such as that of cab drivers, shop vendors, etc. In the 90s, the US opened doors to Indians throughout the upper echelons of corporate America with the rise of the dot-com generation. So today we see the Indian population in the United States as prosperous, well-educated, group occupying an important niche in the immigrant population of this country. Despite the standard of self-sufficiency that the Indian immigrants have maintained in the eyes of dominant Western Caucasian society, there are several conflicts that this group faces as it moves in and out of its cultural spheres in American society. First, I would like to examine the spatial identity of the Indian immigrant and show how important the notion of space is to the immigrant by looking at some of the fiction of Bharti Mukherjee and Chumpa Lahiri. Suffice it to say that when the Indian immigrant arrives from India, he or she comes with both metaphorical and physical baggage. In India specifically, the geographical space of the country has been physically challenged over centuries. This is one subcontinent that has been conquered on numerous occasions by foreign invaders, beginning from the Greeks, Alexander the Great, to the Persian and Muslim invaders, to the British, causing diversity in both language and ethnic origin of the Indian people. Before the British reigned supreme in India, it was the Mughal or Muslim kings that ruled India, and since the Muslim influence was much greater in northern India, attempts to impose Hindi, a northern language, on a national level failed in the south, leaving English as the lingua franca in India. Also, because of the various foreign invasions in India, the people are varied in their customs, culture, and religions throughout India. Although this calls for diversity, India has been racked by civil violence, religious and separatist strife for the most part of its modern history. So Indians arriving in the United States don't see themselves as South Asians, but more in religious, regional and linguistic terms. Indians belonging to the older generation also separate themselves through class and caste. So the term South Asian becomes more of a political construct. At any rate, Indians come to the US with a definite idea of space ingrained in their psyche. They are regionalized and surround themselves with people belonging to a similar geographical space or region. So we have the Bengali Association, the Gujarati Association, etc. In the examination of Bharti Mukherjee's fiction, one sees her exploring through her characters a fracturing of an already ambiguous identity, as you have seen in what I've just stated. If we briefly examine Mukherjee's short fiction, say for example from her collection Darkness, we see characters being constantly shuttled between ideas from their native country and their adopted country. Even when these characters become American citizens, they cannot be, quote, reborn because of their nativistic beliefs of class, caste, and regional conflicts. For example, the character of Leela in Mukherjee's short story Hindus. Although Leela marries an American, she cannot live with him because she is haunted by the fact that she belongs to the highest caste in the Hindu system. On another occasion, when she meets her father's friend at a party populated by immigrants from other countries, Leela speaks to him in Hindi, but is irritated when the other immigrant guests are familiar with the Indian culture. She notes, "There's a whole world of us now speaking Hindi." According to one critic, Fakhrul Alam, Leela's ambivalence of her status in America on the one hand expresses a sense of defiance and on the other registers a consciousness of the demographic changes taking place in the US because of a large number of immigrants coming from Asia. In Mukherjee's other novels, such as The Tiger's Daughter and Jasmine, she is criticized for giving us characters that are polarized into two different groups, the privileged and the underprivileged. The underprivileged are the rebellious insurgents of the Naxalite group that caused much upheaval and terror in Bengal in the 1960s and 1970s, and the privileged class are the ones that they were fighting against. Mukherjee belonged to the privileged class, and in glossing over the lives of the underprivileged class, we see the subtle invasion of the metaphorical baggage of class, caste, and regionalism that Indian immigrants carry with them, regardless of whether or not they're characters in the novels or the novelists themselves. In the novel Jasmine, Mukherjee is criticized for allowing her protagonist Jasmine to completely erase her Indian past and assimilate into dominant white American society. On the other hand, the character of Jasmine is uncomfortable when her name is Americanized into Jace or Jazzy. Although Mukherjee can be criticized for erasing Jasmine's Indian identity, one notes the discomfort of the immigrant character and writer when there is total assimilation within the dominant culture, indicating to us that the erasure of one's past history is impossible, to say the least. Mukherjee also tends to blur the distinction between privileged and an underprivileged immigrant through the character of Jasmine, who is a poor, unskilled, illegal immigrant Indian woman. She is shown as having similar opportunities and problems as an educated, wealthy Indian woman. According to the critic Gurleen Gerwal, Mukherjee is making a mockery of the Indian immigrant's life in dominant American society. Although in my estimation, if one looks at the lives of Indian immigrant women who are abused and violated by their own culture in foreign spaces, for example in the US, such lines are blurred. For example, in both the Hindu and Muslim religion, the code of honor and shame has been a central issue in community dynamics. So regardless of one's status and locale in society, rich, poor, suburban, urban, educated or uneducated, women who have been abused have not participated in mentioning the abuser. Thus, Mukherjee may have a point in blurring the lines between the different classes of Indian immigrants. Ultimately, the spatial identity of the South Asian Indian is blurred, as I stated in the beginning of the essay. To further stress the ambiguity of the South Asian, Nazli Kibra, in her essay, The Racial Gap, South Asian American Racial Identity and the Asian American Movement, suggests that the race of South Asians have never been clearly defined. Because South Asians do not fall into established racial categories like everyone else, whites, blacks, Hispanics, Native Americans, Chinese, they can be inelegantly considered as, quote, ambiguous non-whites, making them racially marginalized. These so-called ambiguous non-white immigrants have also been characterized by Pulitzer Prize-winning author Jhumpa Lahiri, as she tacitly records their lives in the United States in a collection of short stories, The Interpreter of Maladies, and in her more recent novel, The Namesake. The characters in Interpreter, as political and cultural theorist Homi Bhabha would say, are caught between the intersections of, quote, multiple places, historical temporalities, and subject positions, close quote. Bhabha uses the examples of the Parsis, who are a hybridized community residing all around the globe, and the community to which he belongs. The Parsis, who are predominantly established in India, use Hindu and Muslim rituals and customs while they worship the Persian prophet Zoroaster. In this manner, the Parsis are able to negotiate a cultural identity in India. Similarly, in the examination of Lahiri's characters in her short stories, we see them doing the same as they negotiate a space for themselves in the United States. For example, in the story, The Third and Final Continent, we note how young Indian students in England cling to their traditions of cooking Indian food and watching Hindi movies as they share a single flat while working on their college degrees. One of these young students then moves to the United States after having an arranged marriage in India. He cannot bring his wife to the US till her papers are in order, so he lives as a paying guest with an old American woman in Boston while working at MIT. He has no social life and lives on cereal and bananas, and when his wife arrives, they live a Spartan life, have one son, meet other Bengalis, find shops on Harvard Square that sell cloves and fish, and end up deciding to grow old in America. Yet the narrator ends the story by saying, there are times I'm bewildered by each mile I have traveled, each person I have known, each room in which I have slept. Through such characters, we see the beginnings of, as Bhabha would say, the renegotiations of traditions where locality insists on its own terms while entering into larger national and social conversations. After a few years in America, the man's wife in the story does not cover her head, nor does she weep for her parents in India. The same couple send their son to study in Harvard, yet speak to him in Bengali and decide to grow old in America. The in-between spaces or intersections that these immigrants occupied are seen in simple changes that they make, eating cereal instead of rice, sending their son to Harvard and retiring in the United States. Or, as Mary Louise Pratt would say, these people are transcultural, as they determine what they absorb as their own and what they use it for. Although Bhabha determines the living in an in-between space reduces communities dwelling in these areas from having a single culture, simultaneously though, the hybridity becomes meaningful as cultures are interleaved with one another. Ultimately, there are no clear-cut answers. Occupying a liminal space could also lead to ambivalence and antagonism, because negotiating with the difference of the other reveals the radical insufficiency of sedimental settled systems of meaning and signification. We see Bhabha's ideas of liminality, hybridity, and the space of in-betweenness fairly well developed in Lahiri's novel, The Namesake. In this novel, the protagonist, a young man, is born in the United States to Indian parents and lives his entire life unsuccessfully attempting at negotiating his space in American society. First, the young man is named Gogol, after the Russian writer Nikolai Gogol, and that in itself brings an ambiguity into his so-called Indian identity. As a teenager, Gogol changes his name and uses his Indian name, Nikhil. He does not want to be Indian and hates everything that his parents do and say. As a young adult with a lucrative job in New York, he moves in with his American girlfriend Maxine and her wealthy parents. He only eats gourmet French food and assimilates himself with Maxine's parents and their wealthy friends by spending weekends with them in ritzy neighborhoods in Connecticut. In her article, Minding the Gap, South Asian Americans and Diaspora, Singh, quote, quite clearly critiques the South Asian Indian yuppie. This group's parents came in the 1960s and belonged to the upper class educated Indians. These South Asian immigrants have tried to become white as they seek overcompensation in real estate and material goods, which leads to a sense of liminality in the South Asian identity. We note this aspect of overcompensation in Gogol's character. But despite trying to overcompensate for his differences in Maxine's household, Gogol's liminal identity pushes him from seeking further Americanization, and he ends up leaving Maxine for an Indian woman, thereby positioning himself between simultaneous inclusion, exclusion, assimilation and segmentation, nationalizing and Americanization. Ultimately, the novel ends with a sense of nostalgia as Gogol returns to his parents' home after the death of his father and after his Indian wife leaves him for a middle-aged Caucasian man. As the reader leafs through the final pages of the novel, he or she sees the character of Gogol occupying his childhood bedroom and reading for the first time the story, The Overcoat, written by Russian author Nikolai Gogol, his namesake. I think Lahiri ends the novel in both a complex and ambivalent fashion because she cannot quite tie the ends neatly while describing liminal identities such as Gogol's. Here is a character who portrays the dilemma of the South Asian Indian diasporic identity, which is constantly negotiating cultural differences in non-native spaces. As with Gogol and other Indian immigrants, diaspora precludes any simple reading of national belonging because the diasporic self is situated on fault lines. This is neither then a nostalgic longing for a home left behind, nor a crude exceptionalism in the host country. As Salman Rushdie claims in his essay, Imaginary Homelands, Indian writers writing in English in a country other than their own are able to straddle two cultures. And in doing so, they give us characters, plots, and themes that are fractured. According to Rushdie, the idea of being Indian is getting to be a scattered concept. I am in agreement with Rushdie, as noted in the lives of the characters that both Mukherjee and Lahiri have created. Their characters separate themselves from their homeland and its culture as they change their habits to a degree, such as eating beef or dating Caucasians, or even the case of Mukherjee's protagonist Jasmine and Lahiri's protagonist Gogol attempting at revising their Indian identity. Rushdie compares such changes to the Christian notion of the fall of man as immigrant writers and their characters become, in Rushdie's words, partly of the West. I just want to talk about an interesting controversy within the South Asian Indian community, which deals with American popular culture. In a Chicago Tribune article titled Teens Heritage on Collision Course, shows a popular trend of young Indian teenage girls joining the Miss Teen India USA pageant, which is the first national beauty competition specifically for teenage Indian women. According to one contestant, this is too Western a concept, with too uncertain a future, so she has it hidden from her parents. 41 of these young women are, in the words of the article, navigating a cultural confluence. This is because many of them hail from conservative Indian values and career paths. In my opinion, for these young Indian women growing up in American society and viewing scantily clad pop divas singing about girl power and sexuality, attending mainstream public and private schools in which proms and school dances are flaunting, yet having to live in homes in which their parents are pushing them to follow conservative Indian values, puts their identity in flux. Okay, I'm going to just quickly, since I have just a few minutes, just sort of read my conclusion. If we examine certain third world feminist ideas, women such as these teens in diasporic communities are being marginalized by mainstream popular culture. How? Mainstream American culture, with its glitz and glamour, can be viewed as the master or colonizer, placing the colonized woman, because she's seized by the capitalist culture, into believing that her space is on that runway as Miss Indian Teen USA. In this way, contradictions are nurtured. As the diasporic slash colonized woman is situated outside the center, she is not Miss Teen USA, but Miss Teen Indian USA. Because of all this and what I have said about the characters in Jhumpa Lahiri and Mukherjee's writings and the lives of South Asian women, the space that the South Asian Indian community occupies in its adopted Western construct, which it calls home, cannot be deemed as being entirely stable. As we have seen through the Indian immigrant writers and their characters and the lives of Indians living in mainstream American society, their identity, which stems from a sense of place in American society, is in constant flux. Thank you.
We've been talking this morning about the females. What about the poor males?
Poor males or poor females, if you must use an adjective, are definitely part of the same society. And it's not whatever socialization they have, males or females, both contributed to the present day situation as it was. There is no social change possible, as I've been trying to emphasize, without including the whole community, which includes the males. And if women are empowered to use their own power and not sort of use men as conduits or sons of fascination or male progeny or whatever else, and the fact that they cannot directly represent themselves or directly have a say in their lives, is also partly, I mean, being a sort of simplistic response to why women are obsessed with having sons and why families expect them, but one is one example, require them to be, you know, to have representatives who can have a say in their lives or in their society. If these kind of, if you did not need devious methods to get direct responses, this would not happen, you know. The point is that change would, it's not just women who experience change, or women who are, you know, sufferers, or who can become victims of changes, or when societies are in flux. Men do too. They're part of the society. And the only way to see to it that there is nobody who is suffering unduly, or there's nobody who is being exploited for other vested interests, is to see that things are rationalized, that power is sort of distributed more equitably, and women can have a say in their own lives. The only, and of course the direct answer to this is statistical, that nobody is denying that men are victims of even domestic violence. The statistics are such that there's a 98% plus percentage of women are victims and 1.7% that men are victims. So obviously the concern, fire is where women are, because that's where you're more concerned. And that's the fire you're trying to put out first, and hoping that it's again being domestic violence in the past, then men also belong. Nobody's denying that men can be victims, but the statistics are definitely, you definitely don't worry so much about race, you know, racism in terms of the Caucasian population. It's not that they're not victims of racism, they can be. The victims are the other minorities.
Just a question to Siona. You want to comment a little bit on your love for blue and for women and the space and etc.
Well, I think Sunita covered some topics on space of the immigrant. Both as it's a dilemma, but it's also kind of like picture sitting on a fence where you don't belong anywhere, but you get this view, which is incredible. You know, sometimes, I mean, you really want to belong, you want to be compartmentalized. you know, because it still feels safe. But on the other hand, when you, my work in a way has become a sort of method of decompartmentalizing, so that, you know, when I present, for example, to Asian groups, so to speak, I tend to talk more about my Jewish self, and then vice versa, just because I want to be able to present the other, which I think is not done as much, and also I think is, you know, nationalism and all these kind of isms, that tribalism, all this kind of really worries me. You know, through art, like I said before, I was wondering, you know, what can art contribute? It's always supposed to be considered a little frivolous. Oh, you're a painter, how cute. You know, will you paint landscapes, you know? But besides that, what can art do? What can literature and poetry and all that? I mean, it's I think it's a great tool to be able to bring attention to certain issues. Why I paint myself blue? Because, in short, inspired by the god Krishna, who's the color of the sky, but he's also very dark skinned. He's supposed to be very dark since he's painted a kind of a dark blue. After repeatedly being told, actually, a little bit in India, but also here more so, a Jew from India? I mean, is that real? like all Jews were born in Poland, or came from Poland, which is not true. I mean, Israel is in the Middle East, so, you know, make sense of that. So after being repeatedly told that, and after repeatedly being, you know, the whole, like my husband said, you've got to turn the tape recorder on, yes, and you've got to prove yourself, you've got to say yes. India is very diverse, there are people not only who are Hindus, you know, these kind of stereotypes, there are all different kinds of people. India is a country of immigrants, it's so cosmopolitan, like I can't tell you. So after explaining all that, I came to the conclusion that when I started painting these so-called self-portraits, I started wondering, well, what shade of brown should I paint myself? So I said, maybe blue would be a color that stood out and become a symbol for me as being a Jewish woman of color. So I gradually turned blue. I mean, really. Yeah, so it's a really convenient color. And this way, you know, I mean, I instead of trying to hide it, I stand out. And I use that as a color or as a symbol to bring out certain things. So before I wouldn't want to discuss my Jewishness. I mean, my Jewishness and my Indianness were two separate things, and they were just too complicated to explain. So I always dealt with that. Kind of, my Jewish life was more like living in a bubble, you know, in India also, in a way. Even though there was no anti-Semitism in India, and, you know, my Jewish grandmother lived with all the Muslim neighbors with the mosque and the synagogue right next to each other, and they shared the kosher and the halal stores because it was so much in common. And then she leaves and goes to Israel, and then her grandchildren are sent to the army to fight against these Arabs who are Muslims. So it's just so conflicting. And it's just, you know, it's just incredible. I would never go and live in Israel, though I do visit it often. I do support the state of Israel, but I do not support the occupation, for example. And, you know, so there are certain issues that you have to kind of draw the line in. So all these kind of, like Sunita said, in her paper, you know, the spaces that you occupy and don't occupy, come into question, and art is now become for me like a kind of a never-ending well of iconography, both from my Indian mythology, from my Jewish, and all these symbols that I can recycle, so to speak, and create sort of a new dialogue, a new language, and rejuvenate it, like give it life again. I mean, how many times have I sat and listened to, you know, my rabbi tell stories, you know, about certain things, you know, and of course. But how do you take these characters and then turn them around and make them characters of today is kind of being very energizing.
Have you made your presentation in Israel?
No, you know, actually, I haven't been to Israel for quite a while, since the late 80s. And the reason being is that, actually, there are some peace activists, Jewish peace activists, friends, totally left-wing, who are in the very involved of the peace movement and have actually been thrown into jail for siding with Palestinians and, you know, kind of coming to real peace terms. They're trying to bring some of my art over there. So we're just trying to kind of, or bring me over there to be able to, again, become that artist activist so I can, through my art, be able to talk about certain issues. Otherwise, it would be very difficult for someone, like, for anybody. So using that, as you know, I found that it's a valuable
that would be a wonderful experience.
Yeah. I haven't even exhibited in India since, because my family is dispersed so much. There's no family I can go back to.
Are there any other questions? If not, I think we should give a big hand to your panelists.
Can just wait for one more minute. I would like to certainly thank this panel. Very fascinating, very interesting. I wish we had more time for some discussion. When we heard weather forecast, we were a bit skeptical. Tom and me and some others got a little concerned about attendance and food and all that. We even thought of, you know, cutting our number of food, you know, orders that we had placed. But then we decided it's okay to have some extra food. I was very pleased to see, I was doing a little counting during the middle of the day, and we had some 60 people in attendance. Our target was 70. So we were very close to our target. As I said in the morning, Newsweek has come up with an article on South Asian communities. We had not collaborated with them, it was just a coincidence, but we are certainly in good company to have organized this session at Baruch on South Asian communities. There are a number of theoretical, methodological questions that we need to deal with when it comes to this concept of South Asian communities or South Asian identity. A number of people came to us during the break, during the lunch, to talk about it. And because of limited time, we could not expand on these discussions. But I would very much hope that you would communicate with us. We have very active and energetic executive director, Dr. Thomas Tam, who really provided leadership in organizing this conference. And Nick, who served as conference coordinator, and Anthony, our media director here, and some other members of the staff. They really worked very hard, and I want to thank them for that. Last but not the least, your attendance, your support was critical. Being a Friday, snowy and rainy day, many of you came, and somebody came from Florida. I know our good friend Betty Sung probably cut her vacation short from Florida and came to New York for this conference. So we are really grateful, and we hope to continue this process and do some follow-up sessions and seminars and talk about variety of issues. You know, we issues sometime maybe just focus on issues that you introduced about SAKHI. When I started doing my research on Indian immigrants, that was not a major issue, but I think the last 10, 15 years it has become, and perhaps, you know, it is time to address some of those issues that our communities are confronting. Again, thanks very much. Have a great weekend.